my every move. With every new imagining, he whispers in my ear. Even when I've nothing left to prove, he's painting possibilities of failure and despair. So God, I'll stand with open hands. Help me on the hurt behind the sin. Let healing and forgiveness flow like cool, refreshing rain. So with each day, I'll choose to say. With laughter and sorrow, yeah, courage to take one step at a time. Today is my gift, not tomorrow. Courage to walk with Christ in my sight, the path strewn with laughter and sorrow.
Good morning, everybody, and welcome to worship this morning at Golden Grove Church on this third Sunday in the season of Advent. As we come into worship now, let us be called to worship by Mary singing her famous song of praise to God that's recorded in Luke chapter 1 when she receives the amazing news of what God is doing in her life, bringing her to be the mother of the Saviour to be born at Bethlehem at Christmas. Mary's song, and this is the set psalm for today. My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Saviour. For he has looked with favour on the lowliness of his servant. Surely from now on all generations will call me blessed. For the Mighty One has done great things for me, and holy is his name. His mercy is for those who fear him. From generation to generation, he has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, according to the promise he has made to our ancestors, to Abraham and to his descendants forever. And we're going to continue in that same vein now in praising and worshipping this amazing God of the gospel. And we're getting into the mood of Christmas very much now, so we're going to start off with a couple of wonderful Christmas songs this morning. That firstly, Angels from the Realms of Glory, followed by Joy to the World.
Angels from the realms of glory, wing your flight over all the earth. He who sang creation's story, now proclaim Messiah's birth. Come. Come and worship Christ.
Christmas is coming, don't we know it? I've just been down to TTP, and I tell you what, getting a park is getting harder and harder. Today, on our Advent wreath, we light three candles, and each candle represents something very important. Our first candle, you remember, was a candle of hope, and still is. The second candle is the candle of peace, and the third candle, which we light today, is joy. Let me read today from Isaiah chapter 55, verse 12. You will go out in joy and be led forth in peace. The mountains and hills will burst into song before you, and all the trees of the field will clap their hands. And the third candle of joy today is the pink one, a most special day. Let's pray. Gracious God, you came to us in human flesh, and you abide with us in the Holy Spirit. Fill us with your joy and help us shine as a light to the world through Jesus Christ, who makes our joy complete. Amen.
We're now going to come before God our Father with our prayers of confession. Let's pray. Almighty God, most merciful Father, who created us for life together, we confess that we have turned from your way. We have not loved you with all of our heart. We have not loved one another as you commanded. We have been quick to claim our own rights, but careless of the rights of others. We have taken much and given little. Holy God, whose compassion never ends, we ask you to forgive us our sins and to blot out all our guilt, that we may know again the joy of your Spirit through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Heavenly Father, in great mercy, has given his Son Jesus to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. And so, by the authority of Christ, I therefore declare to you the forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We're now going to sing again. This is a fabulous Christmas song. Today is the Saviour's Day. And it's a song that I guess ideally has in mind Christmas Day itself, and we'll get a chance to sing it again then. But because Christ came at Christmas, every day is his. He is the Lord who has come into our world and into our lives and has never left.
Fire in my soul today, everything can change. There's a flame in my heart that'll never grow cold. today is the Savior's day. Though the path may be covered in virgin white snow, your starlight will guide the way. And the angels are singing, we are not alone. Today is the Savior's day. And healing again. Today is the Savior's day. Yeah, today is the Savior's day.
Pretty obvious, today we are worshipping online and with our service which has been pre-recorded for this morning. We sent out information during the week that because of the level of number of COVID infections we have amongst members of the congregation, that we decided that it would be wisest this week to help break that chain of transmission a little and to help us as a congregation to get through the current outbreak as quickly as possible, that it would be good not to worship in person this morning but to have worship online this week. We'll review that next week. We hope that it will be a matter of being able to return to normal next week, but we'll inform you about that through the week. We're going to come now and spend some time in prayers for others and for our world. And I'll lead us in this time of prayer and also allow a time of silence for you to be able to contribute your own prayers for those who are on your hearts at this time. So let's come in prayer and then we'll follow with the Lord's Prayer. Let's pray. Dear God, our Father, you sent your Son, Jesus Christ into the world as the King, as the Saviour for the world. Father, to bring your love and grace to all people. And so we bring our prayers, Father, for our world in its great need at this time. Father, we are very mindful that our community and the world is not yet out of the woods from the COVID pandemic. And it's affecting us in a particular way here at the present. Father, we thank you that you have shown yourself faithful to us to meet our needs through the years now that we've been moving through the COVID pandemic. And we thank you, Father, that we're in a much better position than we were 18 months, 2 years ago. And so is the world. Father, we continue to pray that you would provide in your great grace through medical understanding and treatments, through vaccines, through measures that we can take across our societies to be rid of this virus very soon. Father, we pray that you would be with all of those who are affected with the virus and keep them safe and grant them healing and bring them through this sickness quickly and strongly. Father, we are very mindful of the situation still in Ukraine, the terrible war that has been going on for so many months and so much unthinkable damage that has been done and pain and suffering. Be with all those suffering because of this situation, Father. May they know of your love. May they know of your presence. May they know that your mercy and grace is upholding them. May you give them a way to escape danger. And Father, may you very quickly bring to an end this conflict and restore peace. Father, we're very mindful too of the ongoing flood situation across our nation and in South Australia, particularly in coming weeks around the River Murray. We pray for those communities and all the people who are affected. Father, may they also know that you are not a God who abandons us in our trouble, but the God who is with us and who upholds us. And I pray, Father, that those who are in fear and danger may look to you in faith and be strengthened and renewed in faith and hope. We also pray, Father, that you will provide the help that is needed from government, from the community, from ourselves where we're able to help practically, Father, protect our communities and to help them in the restoration process, that that'll be a quick one. Father, we pray for people across our communities who don't know how much you love them, who don't know the great purpose and plan that you have for their lives, who don't know, Father, of your forgiveness, who don't know of your grace. And we pray, Father, that they would come to know you, particularly those we meet in our day-to-day lives, and that you would work through us to be able to love them practically and to share our lives with them, our friendship with them, and our faith with them, and that you would be at work in their lives to draw them to yourself. Father, we also bring now to you the prayers and the needs that are on our hearts. Father, we bring all of these prayers confidently because Jesus has come and shown us your great love and mercy. And we are confident also, Father, to speak to you the words of the family prayer that Jesus himself taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Do not let us be tempted, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. In this time of Advent, looking forward to Christmas and celebrating that great event, we're also thinking about waiting for God for the fulfillment of his purposes for the whole of history. And this is a Christmas and an Advent song that sums up all of those expectations. The waiting for Jesus when he came the first time and our waiting for him to come to conclude and fulfill history. Come, thou long expected Jesus. We're not physically bringing our offering today, this morning, but many of us bring our offerings via other means through electronic channels, and we'll have the opportunity, probably the offering we would bring today, to bring that on another time. But most of all, we're offering ourselves when we come to God in worship. So let's just pray in asking God to bless what we offer. Father, we thank you for the great gifts that you have given to us. You provide all we need for life. Above all, Father, you have given richly your love and grace and mercy that fulfills and overflows our greatest expectations. And so we give to you, Father, the gifts that we offer and ourselves, and pray that you take what we offer and in your grace bless it to the service of your kingdom. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Our reading for today comes from Matthew chapter 3, verses 1 to 12. In those days, John the Baptist came, preaching in the desert of Judea and saying, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is near." This is he who was spoken of through the prophet Isaiah, a voice of one calling in the desert, "Prepare the way for the Lord, make straight paths for him." John's clothes were made of camel's hair, and he had a leather belt around his waist. His food was locusts and wild honey. People went out to him from Jerusalem and all Judea and the whole region of the Jordan. Confessing their sins, they were baptized by him in the Jordan River. But when he saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees coming to where he was baptizing, he said to them, "You brood of vipers! Who warned you to flee from the coming wrath? Produce fruit in keeping with repentance. And do not think you can say to yourselves, 'We have Abraham as our father.' I tell you that out of these stones God can raise up children for Abraham. The axe is already at the root of the trees, and every tree that does not produce good fruit will be cut down and thrown into the fire. I baptize you with water for repentance, but after me will come one who is more powerful than I, whose sandals I am not fit to carry. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand, and he will clear his threshing floor, gathering his wheat into the barn and burning up the chaff with unquenchable fire." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Well, today's reading from Matthew 3, 1 to 12, is about the ministry of John the Baptist. And John's message was about getting ready for the Messiah to come, the one who would be God's true appointed Saviour King for the people. We've been hearing quite a bit about the coming of the true King through Advent so far in preparation for celebrating Christmas. And so the true King is God's Son, Jesus Christ, who was born as a baby at Christmas. And this was his first Advent. Advent comes from a Latin word that just means arrival. So it's his first arrival or coming visibly into the world that happened at Christmas. And during Advent, we also focus on the King's second Advent, which will be at the end of history to judge all people and to usher in a new eternal heaven and earth. But as we've been reminding ourselves through Advent, we also think about the King's present Advent, his coming now into our lives, into our world, by the power of the Holy Spirit. So, how do we properly prepare to meet, to receive the King? There was once a quite famous reception of a king, or at least of Prince Charles as he was then, on Australia's iconic pop music TV show, Countdown, hosted by the show's presenter, Molly Meldrum. And look, if you Google it, just Google Prince Charles Countdown interview, you'll see it. It is absolutely excruciating. Molly, who was inarticulate at the best of times, being a snotty-nosed Melburnian punk who made it lucky, was overawed by the occasion and the Prince's presence, and proceeded to tongue-tangle, squirm and sweat his way through the attempted interview, which must have only lasted a few minutes and actually had to be abandoned before it was supposed to finish, yet it seemed like interminable hours. Let's just say that Molly was not properly prepared to receive royalty. But are we better prepared to receive God's true King? We're going to see how to be truly prepared to receive the King by looking at, firstly, the nature of the King's kingdom. Secondly, why we resist it. And thirdly, how we truly receive it. So firstly, the nature of the King's kingdom. It can sound a bit like the successful arrival of the King is dependent on us. If we read verse 3 in Matthew chapter 3, it references Isaiah 40, verses 3 and 4, and it speaks there of preparing for the King involving building a highway for him, which will mean needing to fill the valleys and to remove the mountains in order to make this highway. But no, it's not dependent on us. He's the King of the universe, as the Jews truly call God. So what that means is he comes when and where he wants. He will and does come into and intersect and interrupt our world and our lives. The question is, are we ready to receive him and his kingdom? That is, are we attuned to his kingdom? Will we accept it? And will it therefore accept us? And so we need to see what that kingdom is like in order to know how to be properly prepared for it, how to properly receive it. John the Baptist's cry echoes the cry of God's people, as we mentioned in Isaiah chapter 40. And this was 500 odd years before the time of John the Baptist, and their homeland had been invaded, their infrastructure had been destroyed, and they had been, many of them, taken away into exile by the Babylonians. And I guess probably felt much like many Ukrainians would be feeling at the moment. And their cry was a cry for God to rescue them, to forgive them, they needed that, and to heal and restore them and their homeland, and to rebuild and enrich them as a nation again. In Isaiah, this cry of the people is also combined with a promise from God that he would do just that. And the people continued to recall this prophecy, this promise, right up until the time of John the Baptist. During those 500 odd years, they had received partial restoration from the exile, but they continued to be invaded and oppressed by various nations, and to experience being cut off, exiled from the peaceful, flourishing life that they longed for. Many parts of the world experience similar things today. Our progress through the COVID pandemic still leaves us exiled from what we knew as conditions of healthy, flourishing life and community before the pandemic. Many parts of the Christian church are persecuted and torn apart. And in a sense, the church, God's people, always has and always will know one degree or another of persecution and exile. Jesus promised that we would, just as he himself was persecuted. And this promise from Isaiah that John the Baptist references here in Matthew 3 is based upon God's grace that called and created Israel as his special people from the very beginning. God chose them, forgave them, blessed them. He promised to care for and sustain them and to lead them into a relationship with him in a blessed land that would last forever. And God promised that he himself would be faithful to ensure that this happened, even if the people failed him, which he knew that they would from the beginning. Read about that in Genesis 15. Do we worry that our relationship with God may fail because we know that we are weak and fail? And because of that, do we fear that we could even lose everything that we most value? Well, God has promised to be faithful against our failure and to overcome it. The other crucial thing in our passage about God's kingdom, what it's like, is this. Verse 2 says that it has drawn near. It has drawn near. In the Bible and in Jesus' teaching, it tells us that the kingdom of heaven or the kingdom of God has drawn near or have come among us. The kingdom of heaven is not just a place you go to when you die. It will certainly include a real and eternal world where we will live in perfection. But much more than that, the kingdom of heaven is simply God's rule everywhere in the universe, now and forever. And we know God's rule now, his kingdom now, the reality of it, through faith and by the power of the Holy Spirit. One day we will see it and sense it in every possible way. But through faith we know and enjoy the benefits of God's kingdom, the kingdom of heaven, now. That is why we get to experience what forgiveness is, what God's love is, his acceptance, his peace, the real hope for the future. Joy that can't be crushed or destroyed. Healed relationships, possibilities of renewal in the world. They come because of the influence of God's kingdom of heaven. And the truth about that kingdom is that it has come near to us. Now, when we come into a relationship with God and into his kingdom, it's always because God comes to us first. In fact, before we even move one inch towards him or even think about it. Jesus said, no one ever comes to him unless God the Father has first gone to them and drawn them to Jesus. Jesus said, you did not choose me, but I chose you. Jesus first went to the disciples on the Emmaus Road and walked and talked with them before they believed in him. God comes to us first. In Genesis 28, in Jacob's famous vision of the stairway to heaven, contrary to popular belief, this is not about Jacob building a stairway to heaven and then climbing his way up it. No, it's exactly the opposite. God himself throws the stairway down from heaven to earth. Then God sends his messengers, the angels, from heaven down the stairway to earth, taking and ministering the life and gifts and blessings of heaven to Jacob and to all who need them on the earth. So it was a great tune, Led Zeppelin, climbing a stairway to heaven, but it's just that it's not true. And that's Christmas too, isn't it? The King and his kingdom come down from heaven, are born into our world, into our lives, into our flesh and blood as the baby Jesus in the manger. So that's the nature of God's kingdom. It's the kingdom of his grace, eternally guaranteed to us in grace, and that has come as near as it's possible for it to come in grace. And so the question for us to answer then is, how do we properly prepare to meet and receive that kingdom of grace? Well, we'll get to that. But firstly, our second point, what makes us reject that kingdom? Well, from what we've seen is the definition of the kingdom of God, the kingdom of his grace, what then would be the definition of sin? Well, sin would be rejecting that grace, wouldn't it? And if we reject grace, then the only alternative is to rely on our own strength and ability to try and make it in life, succeed and find fulfillment by ourselves, out of ourselves. And that's what Adam and Eve did in the garden. They said to God, "Thanks for the paradise and all the limitless goodies, but I'll rely on my own resources instead. We'll take our chances on picking that fruit over there. We know that you've said no, but we're going to take matters into our own hands anyway." And you see, that is also the spirit of the little Aussie battler, you know, who says, "I'll try the hardest I can, I'll do the best I can, and I'll make it in the end. And if anyone doesn't like that, even God, well, they know where they can go." That's actually making ourselves our own king and queen, pushing God off his rightful throne as king. And if we've made ourselves king or queen, consequently, we'll also treat others as our subjects. Do we ever look down on people? Are we ever critical? Do we judge them? And if we are the center of our world, then that is the very opposite of grace. Instead of being self-giving to others, in fact, it is selfishness, self-centeredness, grasping. So if we reject grace, we head down the path of anti-grace, self-centeredness, and every sin that exists flows out of that. Someone once said, if we reject the kingdom of God's grace, we set up our own mean little kingdoms in its place. That is, our own little kingdom that is selfish, that is grasping, that is critical of everyone. Do we do that? Do we reject the kingdom of grace and prefer the kingdom of self? Why do we do that? It's because we are all addicted to being king or queen of our own lives. But notice John the Baptist even has a problem with the Pharisees and Sadducees, actually especially has a problem with them. But these are the good Christian churchgoers, us. They seem to do the right thing. They went out to be baptized like John had asked them to. But underneath their religion and morality and charity, which was very significant, they were very good, exceptional churchgoers, yet they rejected the king and kingdom of grace. Instead, they were using their religion in order to be their own saviours and to be in control of their own destinies. They said, we're Abraham's descendants, so we'll be right, mate. And we might say, we do the proper church stuff, so we'll be right, mate. But no, we won't. The Pharisees and Sadducees actually served the kingdom of self under the guise of being God's people. And that's possible for us good churchgoers, just like it was for them. And this is no light thing. As we noted, it is anti-grace, it is anti-God. In other words, it is sinful, it is evil. And John the Baptist states this plainly when he calls the Sadducees and Pharisees vipers. It's no small thing to reject the grace of the King and of his kingdom. So now three, how then do we truly receive the kingdom of grace? A way of describing the true way to receive God's kingdom is with a word that is very prominent in our passage from Matthew 3, which I haven't mentioned yet, and that is the word to repent, to repent. And you might think, well, why didn't you just say that? That would be much easier. Just tell us to repent. Yes, but what does it mean to repent? We might think we know, but maybe not. Repentance is often thought of as a legal process. It goes something like this, that we become aware of our sins, we acknowledge them and feel bad about them, we make efforts to deny them and to make ourselves better people. And by this process, we hope to make ourselves more acceptable to people and hopefully to God. And if we do, then we are rewarded with access to the kingdom of God. And this is how the religion of the Pharisees and Sadducees worked, and that of many Christians too. John Calvin called this understanding of repentance legal repentance. And he said that it is against the Christian gospel and God's truth. What's God's truth, as we've been seeing this morning? God's truth is that his kingdom has already come to us in grace with all of its good gifts, and we simply receive it by faith. Therefore, repentance cannot be a legal process whereby we climb or work our way into the kingdom of heaven. That's impossible, because the kingdom has already come to where we are and embraced us. John Calvin called a true understanding of repentance evangelical repentance. And evangelical is a word that in its origin just means gospel or good news. And so this is an understanding of repentance as good news repentance. That is, it's about embracing what is true and rejecting what is false. Why? Because of the stunning good news that the kingdom has already become fully ours by grace. This is as opposed to legal repentance, which is definitely bad news, because what it tells us is that if we succeed in a laborious process of atoning for our sins and improving our lives, then we might gain access to God's kingdom in the end, but it's a very big maybe. There will and must be great changes that come about in the lives of Christians. We are to be conformed more and more to the likeness of Christ, Paul tells us. John the Baptist refers to these changes in our reading as the fruits of repentance. Now, the fruits of the tree are not the tree. And so the tree in this case is repentance, which is receiving the kingdom of grace. The fruits of repentance are the changes and growth in life that come from the fact that we live in the kingdom of grace. The fruit come over time, sometimes progressing, sometimes receding, sometimes they fail. And that does not affect our place in the kingdom of grace at all. Now, if there is no fruit whatsoever, no signs in us of the life of the kingdom of grace, that is a different story. In that case, it's probably a sign that we have not repented, that we have not received the kingdom of grace, and that we may be rejecting it. In which case, we shut ourselves out of it and its benefits. And if we persisted in rejecting it till the very end, it could be that we are shut out of it forever. Cut down and thrown into the fire, John the Baptist says in verse 10. And John the Baptist very seriously warns the Pharisees and Sadducees and churchgoers about this. Just in conclusion, we repent. We truly receive the kingdom of heaven because it has already come to us in grace and laid a total claim upon our lives and wooed and won us with its truth and beauty. Let me just read those last couple of verses from our passage. John says, I baptize you with water for repentance, but one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to carry his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand, and he will clear his threshing floor and will gather his wheat into the granary, but the chaff he will burn with unquenchable fire. This speaks of the holiness of God burning up and destroying the kingdom of self and our sin. But you see, at the very same time, this is the burning fire of Jesus' love for us. Yes, because in his suffering and death on the cross, Jesus actually had that fire and judgment that was due to us fall upon himself, so that we could be saved from it. That is how powerful and beautiful his love is for us. But it also says there that Jesus takes that overwhelming, unquenchable fire of his divine love for us with all the power of the Holy Spirit, and he baptizes us with it. In other words, he plunges that love into our depths. He floods and fills our being with it. And he makes it flow in our marrow and in our veins. And as he does that, we will not be able to resist receiving that love, taking hold of it with all of our heart, mind, soul, and strength. And we won't be able to stop responding with that same burning love for God and for all people. Amen. We're going to continue in worship now, singing another really wonderful Christmas song, and a song that speaks about the kingdom of grace that we are waiting for, and that even now comes into our lives by the Holy Spirit. Joy has dawned. Let me say for us now the benediction for our service this morning, and these words come from Revelation chapter 22. He who testifies to these things says, "Surely I am coming soon. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. The grace of the Lord Jesus be with you all. Amen." And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with us this day and stay with us forever. Amen. And our final benediction song this morning is The Blessing.